Stephanie and I are our best friends. We're co-portfolio managers together for my charitable trust. You've seen her. She's a CNBC on all the great shows that I love, on Scott Wapner's show. You've been on Melissa's show. You've been on The Closing Bell. And what we just want to kick things around is if you were in our office, because every single day we debate stocks. And the book is a lot about the way that we think. So I think first what we do is you get into like what we're trying to do in the book, and then we'll have the conversation that we have every single day that I think people really want to hear.
Which starts at 4 a.m. before we get on the treadmill.
She hit me this morning at 4, I guess it was about 4. I was up, so I hit you back immediately.
Like 2 seconds later.
It was an analysis of the GM dividend. And whether it's, you know, how much of good news it really is, because there's another colleague that we have who would say it's not that good. And we, you know, our conversations are usually like, that guy is an ignorant moron. He does not understand how good GM. So I want to try to give you a flavor for everything. I didn't mean to cut off Stephanie before she began, but I want it to be as informal as possible, even in a large setting.
Right.
So here we go.
Well, so I wanted to start with a macro question for you first.
Okay.
So when I read the book, what stood out to me was the unique combination of your macro analysis, kind of the big picture, themes, strategy, but you married it really well with stock-specific micro analysis, right? And this book is chock full of ideas.
I mean, right,
a ton
right.
of stock ideas and recommendations, but you explain it so simplistically so that people right. can understand. Well, and so to me, that's what this book is. This book is so much different than your six other
books. They're not like any.
And so I just kind of wanted to get your thought process on crafting, how you crafted the book.
Sure.
And then we can go from there.
Well, what I always feel like is that I like to put myself into the head of a viewer. And not just a viewer of Mad Money, but a viewer of Squawk on the Street, viewer of all our good programs. In the head of that viewer is, why am I hearing about Europe? Okay, what does Europe have anything to do with it? Why are they telling me about the Spanish employment number? Why are they saying that it matters what the Japan, the tanking book says? Why do we care about what the Federal Reserve's doing? Because I think for most people, it seems ridiculous. It seems like we're didactic, that all we're really doing is showing off our own smarts, and therefore we're not helping you. But all of those different items, whether it be the Philly Fed Index, the Empire State, all these are part of a big mosaic. They're not really even that important when taken by themselves. I even say, listen, only one number taken by itself matters, the employment number. But what I'm trying to do is create what I first learned when I started my hedge fund, which is that you need a worldview. You have to know or be confident in how you think the world is doing, how you think America's doing, how you think what are the prospects? What do you feel the prospects are? And the book is about having your own view. I'm not trying to tell you, by the way, what my view is, because I want the book to be good 5 years from now. And one of the things that I was really, really focused on was, what would this book look like 5 years from now? Would it hold up? And the answer is yes, because what I'm trying to do is get you comfortable with what you think. Because what's happened is that if you don't have a view of what's going to happen in the future in our country, in the world, in China, you'll end up doing the wrong thing. Because you'll pick a stock and it won't fit with the worldview that you might have or that you didn't even bother to develop. And you'll see the stock down, and it'll be down because of this mosaic that I'm talking about. So I wanted you to be able to craft your own mosaic of what you think the world is, and give you some examples of what should be part of that mosaic and who can help you, whether it be the Caterpillar conference call or the Alcoa conference call, which we went on last week, which is a thing of beauty. But get the landscape. And once you know the landscape, then you can start figuring out where you are in the landscape and what is right, so to speak. What are the right stocks? What Stephanie and I do all the time is try to figure out, okay, well, you know, I'll say, we had a discussion today about, should we buy Schlumberger ahead of the quarter? Schlumberger being the world's greatest oil service company. I've been on the show many times, so I know the company well. And I'll say, it's not right. But we can't. well, why is it not right? What am I saying? Well, maybe we have too much oil already in our charitable trust. But when I say it's not right, it means that the whole pastiche of the world says don't buy Schlumberger right now. Oil, today oil had a bounce, but oil's been going down, and we know that the tanker rates are not what they were. But then I start checking the tanker rates, and then I start checking what we're hearing from differences. And you're always trying to augment your worldview. But it's with the idea that ultimately, once you figure that out, only then can you start thinking about a sector. And once you figure out the sector, only then can you figure out a stock. And I know that when I wrote it, I was acutely conscious that there would be a lot of people who would say, you know what, I can't do that. And that's good too. I'm trying to get you rich, but I really don't want to get you poor. And if you can't do it, you can't do it.
So once you have a global view and you figure out which sectors you want, you in chapter one, you talk about stocks. There are a lot of things that influence a stock that aren't fundamentals.
Right.
And we're fundamentalists. We look at balance sheets, and we go through conference calls, and we talk to the management teams, and we do a lot of due diligence. And then you own a stock, and it's trading down for no reason, or we don't know why, and so we're scratching our heads. You do a really good job at going through five different points in the book, in this chapter, that are non-fundamental factors that could influence a stock. And you had a good example with Stride, right? And so I thought maybe you could relay that to the
Okay. Group. There's a lot of mystery that's faux mystery in our business. And faux mystery meaning that if you really were to ask some questions that seem stupid, you might get the answers that you need, but no one wants to ask the stupid question because you're so afraid there'll be a judgment made against you. So in 1981, I was interviewing for a job at Goldman Sachs. Goldman Sachs at that point only had, I guess, like maybe 1,400 people, and there was one job. There was only one job, and I wanted to get it. In sales and trading, they were having an internship. They were going to pick four people altogether. And I was the guy that I wanted to get it in the Northeast. So the way you had to do it at Goldman was you had to go to a cocktail party, and you had to impress people at the company. And I started out, there was a guy named David Darst, whom you often see, he's on Friday on CNBC. And he said, you. He just looked at me, he goes, you, I blundered in the cocktail party. I didn't even know what it was. It was like, oh, it's the Goldman Sachs, Ritz-Carlton. I'll go in there. Didn't even have the right clothes on. He goes, you, what stock are you? And I said, well, I'm Exxon. I'm big, I'm strong, and I'm undervalued. And he said, you're coming to New York. And it was like American Idol. You're coming to New York. So I said, okay. And it turns out that I was the only guy from the cocktail party that got the invite. But they're doing 100 cocktail parties. I get down there. And I'm interviewing with one of the people I saw last night at a book party, Walter Haydock, and I'm interviewing with Bill Groovers, a great friend of mine who is a professor of business at Bucknell. And I'm just going down one after another, after another, after another, after another. And I have 9 interviews. And then at the end of the day, there's a guy named Carrie who was running Syndicate. And he said, look, is there anything you want to know? And this is from 9 o'clock till around 6 o'clock I'm interviewing. And I said, you know, there's a question that it's so stupid. This was about 3 o'clock. So stupid, but I got to ask it. And he said, well, what do you want? I said, I want to know, why does a stock go up a dollar? What makes a stock go up a dollar? And he said, you mean like, why does the stock go from, well, pick a number. I said, why does the stock go from 9 to 10? And he said, okay. And he said, how about Stride Right? He hit up the quote Stride Right, SRR. And it was 9 to 9 and 8, basically. And he said, you want to know how a stock goes from 9 to 10? Here. And he picks up the phone and he asks for Eddie. And he says, Eddie, buy me 50,000 Stride Right with a 10 top. And next thing I know, it's 9, 9 and a quarter, 9 and 3/8, 9 and a half, 9 and 5. And he goes, Eddie, slow down, man, slow down. But he said, that's how it goes from 9 to 10, is you get a guy who comes in with a big, sloppy order, and he moves that stock because he doesn't know how to enter an order, which would be buy 50,000, use a 9 and 8th top, call me back in about 15 minutes, see if I want to change the limit. No, guy comes in with a market order. Guy comes in guns blazing. So then you go back to the flash crash, where I was out with my friend Aaron Burnett in the afternoon. And what happened? An order came in. Markets trading like stride right. 9 to 9 1/8, 9 to 9 1/8. And a guy comes in with 50 million stride right to sell. All right, well, it's going to go to 2, or it's going to go to 1. And that's what happened that day, because it's about supply and demand. And it's about how stocks move because there's just less supply. So there's always this facetious, and he said, well, I know you were going to say, you wanted to hear the genuine Wall Street gibberish of more buyers than sellers. But it really is the case of someone moving a stock. And I said to the guy after, and he walked away, the stock goes back to 9. Stock goes from 9.5, goes back to 9. And I said, what happens if you're at stride right? And he said, well, you probably think there's a takeover. Or maybe you think that the earnings are much better than expected. He says, but right now, the CEO of Stride Right is calling every single person in his company saying, do we have a magic sneaker? What do we have? Has anyone heard anything? So, I mean, and I give this because I want people to understand the classic, there are no stupid questions, but also because the business is ridiculously mystified. No one tells you that. No one tells you that something goes up because someone entered an order. And yet that's what a lot of the craziness is about that you see in the market.
But that's why a fundamental analysis is so important, because right. if you do see right. a mispricing in a stock, well, you'll buy it. I mean, we talk about levels every day.
Right.
We have 30 stocks in the portfolio. And every day we look at the price of where it is and where we would maybe add to it if it fell on something crazy like a stride right? Or if something else happens and we really have conviction, we would buy it. Or if we didn't have conviction and it went up like a stride right on no real news, we might sell it. So you have an opportunity.
Right, and we're talking about the $3 million charitable trust when we're discussing it. It's not a mock portfolio, it's real money. We've given away
$1.8 million
from the trust since it began. But Steph puts out the levels every morning and it'll be like, I look at the levels. When I say a level, okay, so let's take GM, all right? So GM's, goes out at 40, the news comes out about the dividend, then it spikes to $40.38, then it spikes to $40.80 by the time Mad Money's on. But then Mike Jackson, who is the CEO of AutoNation, they sell a lot of GM cars, said that there's a big inventory buildup and there's some misanalysis of how the quarter was. Next thing you know, the stock's at 39. So Steph will say, listen, at 38, I think we should buy GM. And it's the level is exactly what I want people to do here. It's what I describe in the book. Which is, at what price would you be comfortable, knowing your worldview, knowing how you feel about the auto sector, knowing how you feel about the consumer, knowing how you feel about GM, what would be the level that you would pay? Now, if you go on Priceline, which is a stock I like very much, that's what you do for hotels. If you go to the mall, you would be totally willing to see this tie and say, wow, this tie is 180. If this tie is marked down to 90, I'm a buyer. Okay, or you go into Macy's and you want to go and you say, all right, I see that they have a typical Macy's shirt that is 50% of all shirts are made by Phillips fan use, 50%. And you see that shirt at Macy's and you know you could get it at another place for less. Well, you're going to say, I'm not paying 60 for that. I can get it for 30. I'm just asking for people to do the same exact analysis for stocks. Use your common sense, graph that on a view of the world, pick your price, and if you don't get your price, don't buy. Now, there'll be some brokers who will get fed up with you because you're a bad client. Because that client, I was a broker, okay? I was like, oh my God, listen to this guy. He's got a 38 top. He thinks he's so smart. The stock's at 40. I got to make another 30 calls because I can't get this guy off his limit. I just want to get the 2,000 share order in. And I'll say, hey, listen, Joe, what's the difference between 40 and 38? And here's what the difference is. When the stock goes to 36, you have no room to buy anymore. You bought all the GM you're going to buy. It's because you didn't wait and you just paid the market, the posted price. Almost everyone in this room would think it was ridiculous to pay the posted price at anything that they do. Why do you do it for stocks? The answer is because you don't know. You don't know that's the way it's not supposed to be done. No one's told you.
So just following on the fundamental theme, chapter 2, you talk about conference calls. I actually think that that's probably my favorite chapter because this is what we do. This is how you learn what companies are all about. These executives have, their ears very close to their competitors and the global views and whatnot. And in the book, you actually say that there's only 21 companies. These are your go-to 21 companies to listen to conference call-wise. There are so many companies to listen to. The S&P has 500 companies. You came down with 21 companies. Why? Why 21? And you have to give the Caterpillar example or the Home Depot example that you do in the book.
Well, I mean, when you're looking at a company, you know that they're spending real money, so they're not economists. Not that it's probably some, I'm not knocking economists, I'm just saying that if you're trying to sell $50 billion worth of product, you got to have a feeling about where that $50 billion worth of product's going to be. If you're selling 10 million tons of aluminum, you have to know where that aluminum is going to sell and into what market it's going to sell. So you have to have these analyses internally about, let's use the Alcoa for a second, because Klaus is not, people don't like Klaus Kleinfeld because the stock hasn't done anything, but he's trapped in this aluminum market. CEO. But what he does is he says, he's a CEO, I'm sorry, and I'm being more shorthanded than I usually, I'm doing shorthand because I want everyone to get the ethos. I'm trying to mimic the ethos. But he sells, where does aluminum go into? Okay, it goes into cars, it goes into trucks, it goes into buildings, it goes into soda cans, it goes into turbines, it goes into airplanes. Okay, those are the main uses. So what he has to try to do is figure out how much those industries are growing, how fast they're growing in China, how fast they're growing in Europe, how fast they're growing in Latin America, how fast they're growing in the United States. He has to figure out the demand of how many cars. We'll do 16 million. We'll sell 16 million cars and trucks this year. We have a 10,000 backlist, back order of airplanes in the country. He believes that we'll make, he has a truck number that he put in. He has a beverage number year over year with winter being weaker because people don't drink as much soda in the winter. And what he does is he tells you whether they're above or below plan versus last year and last quarter. So I'm reading this and I'm thinking, I could have all the economists in the world tell me, I think France looks weak, or I think Spain is bad, or Russia's not that good. Or I could have the guy who's responsible for millions of tons of aluminum going to the right places give me his look, and give me his look in a deck, in a really beautiful deck with lots of great things that he has spent so much time doing. And he's so smart. So what I'm saying is, look, if you don't have your own worldview, let me show you how to get a worldview. Because I'm not going to quit. I'm not going to say, okay, look, you don't know what a worldview is? Well, go buy another book. I'm going to say, listen, you don't know a worldview? Well, just keep peeling the onion until you get to the part of the book where you're feeling comfortable enough to be able to look at the Alcoa quarter or listen to the Caterpillar call, where it's interesting. Caterpillar has great forecasts, and then they don't execute on their forecast because they're just not a very well-run company. They make the best machines. But and then I tell you how to, even because I'm conscious of how time constrained everybody is, I even tell you what pages of the conference call you must read. Now, I am the CEO of this company called Edwards Life Science here. Doctors in the room will know the product. It's a product that makes it so you don't have to crack open the chest cavity in order to be able to put a device in so that someone who's over 80 can still have the equivalent of open heart surgery. And I was really pressed for time. They had to give a speech, and I did. There was just a series of things that went awry today. And it usually takes me about 2 hours to do a 7-minute interview on my show, which is ridiculous, but it does. And I only had an hour, and only an hour for this guy, because I had another guy whose company I didn't know well enough. And I came on, and I was asked to be on the 3:45, and I had to give two speeches. Okay, so, it's a ridiculous day. So I know that there's this one paragraph that is right before the Q&A on every conference call, where the guy tells the truth about what's about to happen. There's 60 pages to this Edwards Life Science conference call. But I turn to page 12, this one paragraph, and in that paragraph it says, we're not gonna do as well as you think. I was like, oh man. So it's like, okay, well, and so the interview starts and I say, why? I don't know if anybody saw it, but I asked a softball question about a lawsuit they won against Medtronic. And then I said, why did you say this? And it was very clear to him that I had done the homework, because it was 20 words that took the stock down 20%. But that's what I'm trying to teach you that too. So you can be your whatever level you want to be. I mean, the book is one part of the book, I would say, is about for people who want to be great clients. And I, as someone who help wealthy individuals and small institutions, I always wanted my clients to be as smart as possible. I never wanted to tell them, you're buying 10,000 Kimberly-Clark. I wanted them to be able to say, I want you to think about this idea of a company that has Kleenex, that has all these great brands that bought Scott Paper, maybe they paid too much, but I want you to be comfortable with it. Because if we buy 1,000 shares and it goes down, I don't want you to think Cramer's an idiot. I want you to think, wow, he really likes it even more, okay? Because he's done the homework. And you know, so I want someone to be a good client like that. I was on a shock jock radio tour yesterday for the book, and he's, heaven forbid you write a book, there's some people you get interviewed by, it's really horrendous. And these guys, you know, a lot of them were basically saying like, oh, come on, it's a big joke, or it's totally crooked, or it's like ridiculous. I said, yeah, okay, on a short-term basis it is. But here, if you're armed with this way to do the research, and you can at least call a broker and say, look, I'm interested in this kind of stock. And that's what I'm trying to do there. I'm trying to do it by saying, if you read the conference call, and there's ones that you have to read, then you will be wise. And I think a wiser person makes more money than a person who isn't. The prevailing ethos in the country is it doesn't matter how wise you are, you can't do it. And I bridled that because empirically I can show you thousands of people who did it. Look, if it was 10 people, it would be anecdotal. If it was 100 people, it would be anecdotal. But at what point do you have thousands of people who've made millions of dollars? You know, because you've touched a lot of people's lives. At what point is that not demonstrative? But unless you've done it yourself, and I'm in a unique position of having probably talked to more investors than anyone in the world, I'm in a unique position to be able to say, look, I see these characteristics of people who have made millions. And the characteristics are they do this checklist. They start macro, then they go micro, they look at the conference calls, they do the homework. And a lot of people on the show will say, what's the homework? What's the homework? Well, okay, pages 20 to 50 are the homework. And that's kind of what I'm trying to do. I'm just trying to get people better at their own money, however they want to handle it.
So in chapter 3, you go through themes, 7 themes that you think have longevity.
Right.
And so therefore, if the market goes up, these companies that are in these themes do well. If they go if the market goes down, they may go down, but you say that they may be the first to bounce.
Bounce, right. I
mean, so talk about that, and then also what you've taught me over the years is go for the best in class in each theme.
Right.
Don't go for number 2 or number 3 if it's on sale. We've tried it, and
sometimes it works,
but a lot of times it doesn't work. So
merchandise is oftentimes appropriately marked by the stock market.
Right.
What I did was in this 7 themes, what I've been trying to do, again, is taking the presumption that the market's going to break, we're going to have a flash crash, we're going to have a Facebook problem, we're going to have many more government fights where you're going to hear about the government perhaps defaulting, and every single one of the government, of the Republican versus Democrats fights have caused the market to go down between 5 and 8%. And I've studied those declines. I studied when they begin, I give you the timeline, I studied how they go down, and then I studied how you see the whites of their eyes, but you have to be ready and buying. But what should you be ready and buying? You should be buying the stocks that fit themes that are not touched by what Washington's doing, not touched by necessarily by what China's doing, not touched necessarily even by employment, because they trump everything. So I give the example of the new frugality. And this is rung home when you do the shock jock thing. It's very easy. You truly try to simplify it, not because I did radio and it got, you know, it's new sports weather. But, you know, what I'm trying to say is, okay, listen, when our parents or our grandparents or some people in the room perhaps, when they got out of the Depression, their mindset changed. And it never reverted to the way it was before the Depression. They were always frugal from then on. And you would see people, my father now, he's incredibly frugal. My grandparents were amazingly frugal. And, you know, it didn't matter that they had some means. Or one side of my family had done quite well. And it just didn't matter. They had the same, they were all frugal. It was like kind of this, it was like a religion. It was like I couldn't believe it. No matter what, no matter how well they did, they didn't change their ways because they had been in the Great Depression. And what I'm saying in with the theme about the new frugality is, a lot of the media doesn't realize, a lot of the analysts don't realize that this Great Recession changed a lot of people's mindsets. And you can capitalize off that. And people don't seem to realize, I mean, it's like, well, sure, Tiffany still had good sales. I mean, BMW had good sales. And we know that Neiman could come public. And that's not what I'm talking about. I call that the Gatsby portfolio. That's the rich are different from you and me. kind of thing. It's a Fitzgerald thing. What I'm saying is that if you take a look at where people shop, it's totally changed. The stock that Stephanie introduced me to, TJX, is a company that buys that Macy's underwear. And Macy's will have a Tommy Hilfiger package or a Hain package of underwear for $24. And you see it lying, unfortunately, lying on the ground a lot at the TJX. It's not well kept. But there's one next door to me that I go to all the time. And it's $8. Okay, well, in the new frugality, you're an idiot if you buy that stuff at Macy's. And I like Macy's for a bunch of other reasons, because they're able to get brands for less because they have so much power. But Costco, I mean, I used to shop at the supermarket for a lot of my staples. And I said, well, you know what? I'm an idiot. I mean, times are tougher. I'm not going to do that. Now, if you look at what I've saved, is it going to impact my life? I mean, I had a turkey wrap before I came in. Would I have, like, gone, I don't know, to Le Bernardin before I came? No. I mean, but I do think that Costco, that TJX, Perrigo. Okay, I used to think, I grew up in a house where if you bought that store brand, and it used to actually be like black, at one point it was like black and white labels, you know, aspirin. If you bought the store brand, it was because you lost your job. You know, and like your mom might say at the supermarket, the A&P, wow, you know, geez, the Millers, I know it's been tough. It's been tough for the Millers. I mean, now I go, and after Johnson & Johnson had those recalls, new CEO at Johnson & Johnson, now a very good company, I've started buying what's known as, about the store brand, whether it be CVS or Walgreens. And, you know, you look at it, and it's the same. And it's all made by one company. It's made by Perrigo. And Perrigo is a stock that's tripled during in this period of post-great of recession and great recession. But Perrigo, Costco, Tanger Factory Outlet. I like a Tanger. There's one out in Riverhead they're building right now. I like Long Island. There's a Tanger Factory Outlet is where you get where J. Crew sells the stuff for half, and Brooks Brothers for half, and it's where Off the Rack is, and you know, off Fifth, and where the Rack is, and you know, these are now part of the culture, but people don't talk about it as a group because Costco's covered by one analyst, TJX covered, you know, Tanger's covered by another, and Perrigo. But if you look at the whole pastiche, you can see that things have changed, and these are stocks that people go back to over and over and over again. And they are not, they're not immune. I mean, if Perrigo screws up and they have to recall all the Tylenol, the Perrigo goes down. So you have to stay on top. You have to, like, Google it. You have to Google Perrigo periodically. It's not the old days. We had to go to the library in Midtown and stuff. But the idea that theme is going away is antithetical to all my work. So I give you the best of breeds of the new frugality. And I think that you're not going to get that necessarily from Goldman, where I worked, because they don't have a new frugality analyst. You wish they did, but they don't think thematically. But you can think thematically.
One thing that you really focus on, big priority in when you invest in companies, is the CEOs and the strength of management teams. And that is certainly something that I underestimated when I first started working with you. And now I have the same high standards. You list 21 of your favorite CEOs in the book. How did you get to 21? Are all the other CEOs mad at you that they're not on that list?
I know. I thought a lot about that. I mean, there's two of them that I bumped into recently. And I said, there were positive examples of you in the book. Yeah, but I'm not one of the 21.
Are there common themes? Are there common traits?
Okay, well, first it was empirical. I looked at all the guests we had. I would not put back up the... I tried to figure out first whether I'd met the CEO and whether I've gotten to know the CEO. And I did that because people hate CEOs in the country. So you had to rebut the presumption that they're a bunch of jokers. And the way you could rebut is say, listen, I've met this person many times. I've had them on the show many times. They've come on the show when things are good. They've come on the show when things are bad. They're always willing to walk me through what's really going on at the company. Okay, so let's eliminate all who haven't been on the show. They could be great. I mean, Frank Blake had not been on the show before I wrote the book. He's the CEO of Home Depot. He's remarkable. So I could not put him in because I hadn't met him. I mean, I talked to him in an email exchange, but he'd never been on the show. And when you're on the show, by the way, it's not just being on the show. You're in the green room with me. We talk after. We try to build a relationship. I know I say it's not about friends, it's about money, but I can't make you money if I think that a guy's a bad guy. And I've been hurt by some bad guys. But what I've done is consistently, since the show's had more than 20, we've done more than 2,100 shows, and it's been on for 9 years, I have a big backlist of who I like. So then I put them through who's done the best, and I was looking for people who are not necessarily at other parts of the book, that, although there's repetition. I didn't like the repetition. There's repetition for Celgene, because he's got, Celgene appears in another segment of the themes, which is the four horsemen of the big, I call it the big pharma apocalypse, because they're wiping out big pharma, these biotechs. But I selected them based on whether they've been on the show, and then how well they've done, and whether they've come on in tough times and good times, and how they weathered the Great Recession, how they handle themselves publicly, how they do their conference calls. So there, is it, can you crack into their world? But I start the chapter with something that's near and dear to many of you, I think, in the room, because the playoffs on Sunday. I say, all right, take Bill Belichick, the coach of the New England Patriots. Take him out of the equation. The Patriots are Denver's favored by four. It was initially favored by six, so the smart money is going toward the Pats. I can't gamble anymore, but obviously I one time liked it. But now you take away, let's say Belichick. Look, John Fox got sick this year. The coach of the Texans got sick. Let's say Belichick couldn't show. Okay, let's just say he couldn't show. Or let's say he resigned today, like the COO. CEO of Yahoo resigned.
And, yes, COO.
Like, what was that about? Well, they resign at the end of the day. Not never a good sign. No. And stock was down a buck in the after hours.
So only worse would be Friday afternoon.
Friday afternoon at 5:30.
Right.
But let's say Belichick were to leave. Well, that line would immediately go to Denver giving 20. I mean, giving 20. Because no one wanted, because someone would know that there's something really wrong. I mean, you know, let's say he were to leave this year, okay? Well, there are a lot of Belichicks. There are a lot of John Foxes. There are a lot of Pete Carrolls. I just think that what over and over again, when you think about who these coaches are, and you want very much to bet on their teams, what I'm saying is we have CEOs, and they're equivalent of a coach in the NFL. And I think that if you were to buy their stock as long as they're there, and I will keep you up on it, because like I said, they come on my show all the time, then I think we have some basis for longevity, for a long-term ownership of stock, which is what I really want. And so I'm equating the CEO to the coach, and I've given you 21 whom I think are coaches whose team you want to bet on.
And you do a chapter on companies breaking up to create value. Right, some conglomerates, or maybe they're not conglomerates, but maybe they have two pieces of business that just aren't doing as well. That also speaks to a very strong CEO that's willing to give up the empire to try and create value.
Or a guy who recognizes, I mean, one of the things is that you write a book, it's funny, you write the book. I started writing this book 2 years ago. Took a long time to write the book. David Rosenthal, my publisher from Blue Rider, kept pushing me to get the book into a larger framework. But in the interim, so you write the book, and I have this chapter in the breakups that Stephanie mentioned, and in it, my first one is that Merck must be broken up, and that they have to break up, they have to sell to Animal Health, because it has no business, because when Pfizer broke up, Zoetis created $10 worth of value, blah, blah, blah. And the book comes out on December 31st, and on January 5th, Merck announces it's going to sell its Animal Health division. And I'm like, to outward appearance, they read the book and they decided to sell the Animal Health division. But there are a lot of companies that feel very pressured into doing what I described. And the way I looked at it is that you take a look at a company like Jim Beam. Okay, Beam is, I do a lot of things in my life that are not on the show, and she listens to me. She has to hear me. I'm opening up a Mexican restaurant in Brooklyn. I am not kidding. Called Bar San Miguel. It's at 307 Smith. And I've had to deal with a lot of tequila distributors. And the one tequila I don't want to have is Sauza, because I think Sauza is awful. Okay? And it's Sauza. And Beam is splitting up. And I'm saying, oh my God, it's the worst tequila. It's the worst whiskey. It's the worst. But it is a brand. It's a liquor company, but it's buried within this thing called Fortune Brands, which is the old American Brands, which was set up by the Duke, and it was like it's a tobacco company, the American Tobacco Company. And they put all these different, American Tobacco Company knew that one day they would be singled out by the government. So they pyramided all these different companies on to bury the tobacco company. And then in the 80s, they broke 80s, 90s, they began to break the company up and it had all these different divisions. But it was still very hard to understand when it was this company called Fortune Brands. And I had the CEO on, and it was like, you know, sometimes, like I said, it takes 2 hours to prep with the CEO. This one took about 8 hours because I kept thinking, all right, why do they have a golf shoe? And why are they like have office manila folders? And why do they have sinks and cabinets and they have liquor? I mean, oh, okay, liquor cabinet? I mean, you know, for the life of me, I couldn't figure out what the heck is this company. So the guy comes in, he's a real nice guy out of Chicago. And I say, listen, man, what the heck are you doing? Like, and just in the green room. I mean, honestly, I mean, I'm trying to figure out how I can do a 7-minute segment with you and not bring up golf shoes and manila folders. I mean, you are like a Walmart. And he looked at me and he said, well, these businesses all have great value. And I said, well, then bring them out. Break the company up so we can understand it. Because when you do that, even if you have divisions that aren't that good, at least someone else can take a swing at it. And so this company broke up Fortune Brands Home and Security. They did Fortune Brands Home and Security, Moe, faucets and cabinets. And once they split that up, I put my money on the Fortune Brand side, which is triple, which is very good. But I also said that Beam would be worth something to someone because, and I know this now from my bar, my restaurant, it is amazing how powerful a brand is. And these brands that you may think not like, they sell like hotcakes. And as soon as this company split up, people, I believe, began to look at this company as a acquisition target. And Suntory, which is a giant private Japanese company, bid for Beam this week. Huge takeover. Fabulous win. But it was all because of the idea that they had to shrink to grow. They had to break up this company. And I think that I give you a bunch of companies that can do that. Now, some of them have been on the move already. But the idea is if you can find a conglomerate and break it up, it's almost always going to trade to a great premium. So you look for a company that could break up that you like. So even if it doesn't break up, you're okay. We were talking about Johnson & Johnson with the diagnostic that could be sold. You put out a nice note tonight. And look at what the divisions would be. And then if it happens, don't sell it.
Don't sell the spin either.
Don't sell the spin.
Don't sell the spin because the spin actually historically has done better than the parent.
Yeah, we're doing one with National Oil Well, Varco now. It's the largest maker of oil rigs.
Because we sold Abbott, and they had AbbVie.
Oh, we sold Abbott.
We sold AbbVie.
Oh, and we're such idiots.
And we should just hold on to them, because they're both, the parent company is leaner and more focused, and the spin is so excited to be on its own.
Right. I mean, Philip Morris, when it broke up, created more value than Apple. Now, everyone thinks Apple is the greatest wealth creator of all time, right? But Philip Morris is. Because buried within Philip Morris was Philip Morris International, was Altria, was SAB Miller, was Kraft, now Mondelez. You had this company of immense value, and it was buried within this kind of weird structure. And once they unlocked it, it created more value than Apple. And I give you ones that I think can create a tremendous amount of value, but you got to hold on to them.
One of the things I think that, again, you've taught me over the years is not to be emotional. And it's really hard when the stocks are going down and you've done so much homework and they just keep going down and down and down. And also the ones that go up, you get nervous too. You're like, well, why the heck is it going up? I must be really good because I did all that fundamental analysis. But it doesn't really work that way.
No.
So one of your best quotes is, you know, when the facts change, you change.
Well, my John Maynard Keynes. But
very
yeah,
good.
You have
it's
to
very
do
good.
That.
It's very
I mean, people
good.
Hate me for that because they think I waffle.
Yeah, no.
It's not politics, guys.
But things change. I mean, it is what it is. So how do you stay objective? I mean, is there, it's hard.
Well, one of the reasons I try to stay objective by using discipline. And the discipline that I use would be don't buy that much at one level. Expect the stock to come down. Continually check on the company if you feel that there's something wrong versus the way, I mean, like why, like, let's use a positive example for a second. We know Intel's going to report a good quarter. We just know because we do a lot of work and it looks like it's going to be a good quarter. But the stock is now up $3 in anticipation. So it's like, oh my God, now it's got to be an unbelievable quarter. Because that stock's up unnaturally from recommendation. That would be one that I would want to sell, but I really think there could be something bigger going on. We watched Bed Bath & Beyond. Sometimes you just...
You had to bring that up.
I have to, because it's you and me at our absolute best and worst. There's a Bed Bath & Beyond. The original Bed Bath & Beyond is about a mile and a half from my house. And my daughter Emma and I love to go. And we go, and she's now in college. Before she went, we bought stuff. We always bought stuff for our beach house. It's just a great store, okay? And Stephanie liked it too. And they've got this thing, Harmon, which we really like. It's really low. My daughter likes to go to Harmon. It's like my daughter thinks she's spending a lot of money. In reality, she's spending $89. But she's, oh, my dad, I look at all the value I'm getting with this nail polish at Harmon.
Well, you go in for $5. You go in for one item. You come out with 25.
You come up with like Mike and Ike's or something. But we both liked it. And we got very emotional about it. Yeah. And I detail line by line, level by level, about even my level structure failed. Because it just kept going below and below and below. And the reason why, it's a very long anecdote. It's a very embarrassing anecdote. And I really feel like at 58, I can embarrass myself. I don't even care anymore. You know, at Jim Cramer on Twitter, what an idiot. Okay, fine.
Thanks for embarrassing me.
Great.
I'm a lot younger than you.
I know what I put it in. I did not show Stephanie the book. I put it in because I said I'm so proud of what she's accomplished and what we've accomplished together. But I want everybody to know, listen, you could be a seasoned pro. I've been at this since 1979. And I blew the bed bath. But I recovered as it came up. It turned out, and there's two lessons to it. One is that your levels may not be right. But the second is, if you really have great conviction and it keeps checking out, don't let your emotions blow you out of a stock. We knew that we had a good one, but we couldn't take the pain. We just couldn't take it. And I would go in one day, we've had ones where I'll come out, I'm a powder keg. And I'll come in, Stephanie, tell what is wrong with 82? What is wrong with 82? There's nothing wrong. No, there's something wrong. I've had fights at home, but these are brutal because there's got to be something wrong. It's going down. Well, Bed Bath was going down every day. And we kept checking out. When I say checking out, meaning that the people would say, oh, well, there's too much couponing. Well, then, it turns out you would check it. It's the same amount of couponing. Or it looks like that the products are all being Amazon. So then I would go aisle by aisle and say, no, that can't be Amazon. That can't be Amazon. No, it's not being. There's just some large seller. Supply is overwhelming demand, and the analysts have got it wrong. And you have to recognize the analysts get it wrong all the time. Well, we ended up leaving 15 points on the table. Now, it finally did happen that they did screw up in the most recent quarter. But I mention it because I want you to understand, one, that the people on TV who act like they've never made a mistake in the world are liars. Mm-hmm. They're just liars. They don't have the confidence that comes from being a pro for a long time, or they want your money and they never want to admit that they made a mistake. So they're valueless to you and they're valueless to me. I'm going to show you I made a mistake. And what do I risk at this point in my career? I risk, well, maybe someone won't watch me. I don't know, one won't read the book. Why not just tell people about mistakes? Because nobody in this room has never, not made a mistake. So I give it to you so you know, oh, man, that was like when Cramer and Cramer and Link were talking about that Bed Bath, and it was like, I know I'm right, but I'm not going to be shaken out like them, there'll be a time that's a better time to sell. And I'm trying to give you a sense of that you're not alone. I can't hold your hand. I do a show every night, show every morning. But that there's a pattern of mistakes that happens over and over again. And if you fall prey to it, know that it's a pattern. And it's not you. It's a broader pattern. And here's how you combat the human nature that does wrong in that pattern.
Thank you. Oh, wow. We have a lot of Q&A.
Oh, geez.
Fabulous.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's start with that.
I do wish that we were mic'd up some. I've often talked about that, doing a show about it. But what happens is that it tends to be Stephanie's on the Bank of America call, right? This morning's long. I talked to the Bank of America people. So she's on the Bank of America call, and I'm trying to figure out, what the heck is wrong? Why is Netflix down 12? I don't understand net neutrality. Well, get me someone who understands net neutrality. Well, it turns out it's not that bad for Netflix, but wait a second, maybe it's bad for Google. We have a position in Google, but wait a second, Nest was really good. But the stock was up $6 billion on a $3 billion acquisition, so it probably sells off. Oh, look at this new note that just came out, which says these raising number Google, raising price target 30. We're just like, Formula One, right? then it's just happening and happening. So it becomes very whirling dervish. But in the end, we're just trying to produce good notes for action alerts and trying to have a good framework for the show and trying to get it right. And everybody on Wall Street at all times is, except for like the Jordan Bell for the Wolf of Wall Street, you're trying to get it right. You really are. We're trying to get it right. I don't think there's a lot of people who intentionally try to get it wrong in order to be able to bilk you. But trying to get it right is really hard. And all we want to do is be a little more right than wrong.
Trying to get it right with an open hand, too.
Right.
Because we do try and educate, and we do try and teach. We do try and get it right, get the right stock picks, get the right sectors, do a lot of the homework. But a lot of the times, it's also hard when we would probably, if you were at your hedge fund, you just said it, you probably would sell a little bit of Intel into the quarter.
Yeah, I'd sell
some. Because it's up so much. It's just up 3 points.
I don't like it when it's up so much. I mean, look, a lot of it's probabilities. Like, I like to play cards, and I'm very good at blackjack. And I know if I stick to the discipline, it's 50.5 for me, and it's 49.5 for the house. Well, I mean, of course, obviously, no one... You flip a coin 10 times. So I remember once I flipped the coin 10 times for my daughter, and I said, and it came up heads every time. And I said, what happens when you flip a coin? She said, it always comes up heads. I mean, you know, things can go against you. But I mean, I'm trying to do a little better than 50.5, 49.5 in the market. But yes, we're just probabilities. We're just trying to figure out the probabilities and go. The Intel probability changed. When it was at 23, there was a good chance for a 5 point up and 2 point down. And that's what I'm always looking for, is five up. If you had a short end of what I'm about, I'm five up, two down. And now it's gone up three. So now it's two up, and it's conceivably five down. So it's just a bad probability setup. So they got to blow the number away. New CEO, don't really know what he's doing, don't like the first year of a new CEO. But it's just a probability switch. Now, if you go on Twitter, people say, I flip-flop Intel. No. Intel at 26 is a different stock from Intel at 23. Now, if you have a long-term view that Intel's going to come back, which is where I'm starting to gravitate toward, maybe it goes to 35. But the fact is that this stock moved up too fast on just voracious buying on the same piece of information.
And our product is not really a trading product.
And we don't trade.
We really can't. But okay, anyway. So let's try and get to a couple of questions, or all these questions. If a company, say Costco, treats employees better than another company, say Walmart, does that de facto make it a better investment?
Yes.
Right?
You know, I spent a lot of time with Jim Sinegal. I love that question, jeez. I spent a lot of time with Jim Sinegal, who's the guy who's the former CEO. Jelinek's real good to the new CEO. They're very down-to-earth guys. Sinegal's one of the great, I think I once said he's like the Steve Jobs of retailing. Mm-hmm. And I did a speech at Bucknell, a buddy of mine, Bill Groover, mentioned, who ran sales and trading at Goldman. He's Professor Bucknell, and he asked me to give a speech about my actual political views, which I never like to do, because they're not mainstream. And and I talked about Lord John Russell and the potato famine, and the British view of the potato famine versus the Irish. And I said that they have a very laissez-faire view. That's what Russell did. Queen Victoria wrote a check out of her own personal account because she saw that a quarter of the people in the country had died. She wrote a $2 million check. And what I was saying in this was I was setting up a situation where you could look at the Walmart view of the world versus the Costco view. The Walmart view is very in sync at that point with the Republican Party, is my view, which was a very laissez-faire. I listen, you just pay them. You know, whatever happens, happens. Costco view is very different. Costco says, okay, what are the best benefits in the world? I care. Best benefits, teeth. Best benefits, health care. Best benefits for anything special for long-term care. What's the highest wage? Okay, what is the best insurance policy for people? And then they say, we want to be more than that in every single category. Now, Costco is the most lucrative retailer in the world. Number one, and think about what they did. They went out and they said, listen, we're not going to be Queen Victoria. We're not going to be Lord John Russell. What we're going to do is we're going to make it so that the people have everything they want. Because what we've learned, human nature, is that they'll never leave if they have the best benefits. And 50% of a retailer's cost is training people. They have the lowest cost of training of any company in the world. No one leaves Costco. Because no one leaves Costco, they have tremendous leadership at Costco. Because no one leaves Costco, they have almost no training costs. Because they have no training costs, they are able to charge less for the food. Because they're able to charge less for the food and they have a card model, they have more people shopping there. I was at a Costco that did $1 million on Saturday. I had been at that Costco many times before to sign books. Every single person was the same person except for another person who had been promoted to run another Costco. Costco is incredibly lucrative and a great investment, much better than Walmart, because they pay their people the most. And is that anecdotal? No, because Chipotle studied Costco, and that's been the best performer in that group. Mm. Whole Foods studied Costco, and it's been the best performer in that group. You'll find over and over again, the great retailers have all studied the Costco model, which has made it so Starbucks studied the Costco model. I mean, Schultz has really studied, remember, they're both Seattle companies. He's really studied the Costco model. These great CEOs recognize that the way to be able to have a great stock is to pay your people better than everyone else, and they'll never leave, and therefore you don't have to retrain. Back to life. Good guys do win.
Right. Does the volume tell you anything about where the price is headed? So today, this person, yeah. Hong, is asking, today Wendy's volume was 42 million versus McDonald's volume of 3.5 million, but both prices went up.
Well, not really. I mean, I used to pay very close attention to volume for if I was trying to figure out whether there was a stock that I owned was going to bottom. Because the way volume, what happens is that as the stock goes down, if it goes down sharply, a lot of times it's on a little bit of volume. And then the volume does what's known as it expands. And when the volume expands, that's the guy who was trying to sell the Stride Right at 9.5. He was banging it down 9.25. Volume expands where a buyer comes in to meet the large seller. So if you have a stock that's going down and you see the volume expanding, that's how a bottom gets formed. So I care if there's a stock goes down on light volume or a stock goes down really big. You'll find a lot of stocks. Let's say a stock goes down $14. Ulta goes down 14. I almost am certain that that stock's going to go down the next day. I've done a lot of studies of that. A big decline of 8 to 10% is almost always followed by another decline. And the reason is because the volume hasn't expanded enough to be able to get all those sellers out. It's a great trick of the trade, but that's for trading. It shouldn't really interest many people here unless you're day trading. I would never day trade Wendy's. Or, by the way, Wendy's is an incredible company because there was an analyst that came out from UBS who recommended outright sale of it at $7. And 3 days later, they went right back in the guy's face and raised numbers dramatically into Dutch tender. But none of that, the volume would only help you if you're trying to figure out how to build a Wendy's position of some magnitude so that you didn't move the stock when you bought it. So volume is really an institutional issue. It's not an individual issue. And individuals who are trying to come up with an analysis on volume, unless they're purely technical and they're trying to figure out where the volume expands at a pivot point, it just won't matter to you.
What's the average length of time you hold a stock? Is buy and hold an outdated approach to investing?
Well, if you have the worldview and you have a long-term theme, buy and hold will work, provided that the company continues to do well. I mean, let's give you an example. One of my themes is people want to live longer through healthy eating. They don't trust the food chain. So my favorite stock in that group is Hain Celestial. It's run by a guy named Irwin Simon, who wanted to be one of the 21. He's a great guy. I put him in another segment of the book. And hey, Irwin, I'm sorry. He's a great guy. And Irwin's view is that it's a land grab, okay? Land grab meaning that there are these great natural and organic brands all over the globe. He bought a company called Tilda. I would ask if anyone's ever heard of Tilda, but I can't see anybody because of the lights here. But Tilda's basmati rice, okay? Which if you go to Trader Joe's, is a big category. And he bought this company and said that it was going to make between 6 and 10 cents for the second half of the year. But the important thing is that he's been buying all these companies, okay? And there's a guy at Barron's who finds Simon's strategy antithetical to his own. And so he says that he believes that the thesis of the Barron's writers, basically, that it's a fad, that natural organics a fad, and all that this guy is doing, Simon's doing, is doing a roll-up, meaning he's disguising how bad his company's really doing by buying more companies. It's like W.T. Grant's is putting up a huge, for those of us who are really old, putting up a huge number of stores but to show growth, but the stores were selling less and less. The same store sales were down. You always have to follow the same store, not the actual growth. So Irwin's buying these companies, and every time he buys one, Barron's writes an article saying, there he goes again. He's trying to hide the weakness in the category. In the meantime, Irwin is being asked by Walmart and Costco to have a full line of all soup to nuts of all foods. So he's doing what his customers want. Barron's keeps writing these articles. Every time Barron's writes the article, which tends to have a lot of unquoted sources, which typically means short, okay, the stock gets hammered. And every time I have to go back to the well on my thesis. Because when a stock gets hammered, I have to decide whether it can still be held. I let the market dictate my homework. It's very unnerving. There'll be situations like this ADT I mentioned, which was a great splash point for us because I think it's a very poorly run company. It's the burglary, you know, the alarm people. And it goes down, and you want to figure out whether it's going down because something's structurally wrong. Is it going down because there's a big seller, the supply and demand strider example? Is it going down because there's some larger macro thing? Maybe they're not going to be building as many houses as they thought. Is it going down because AT&T is a better, or Nest from Google has a better mousetrap? You're always trying to figure out why a stock is going down, and that should test your thesis. It's a legitimate test of your thesis, but there'll be moments where you can't hold it anymore because your thesis is busted. And when your thesis is busted, doesn't matter where the stock is, you have to sell it. So I think there's buy and hold of good quality companies that don't screw up. And at all times, by the way, I mean, you know, Kohl's was a great growth stock when I was growing up. And it was, they were only in a couple cities. And as they swept east and west, the business was doing quite well. And then Kohl's got tired. I was with a really great executive today. He was saying to me, what's the matter with Target, Jim? And I said, Senegal, because I love Senegal so much. Senegal would say, if you were at the table, that Target looks like Target a year ago. It's just the same. It's the same movie. Target used to be a different movie. Every Wednesday, that movie would change. Now, Costco, every Wednesday, I happened to be, at one point in my life, been a food supplier. And Costco put us in for Christmas, and we had a huge Christmas. So we expected it, so we built it. We had the factory running full out. And then we were all set with the next order. And then they didn't reorder. And I said, well, I got a hold of the merchandise guy. I said, well, you know, we had a great Christmas. He goes, people are tired of you. I said, we were in your store for 4 weeks. He said, well, you know, how long do you think a movie runs? I said, wow, never thought of that. Mm-hmm. Well, Target's run the same movie over and over again. I don't need to go there. It's the same place. It's no more excitement, no more destination. The story changed. Target cannot be held. Walmart. I mean, I went to Walmart with my daughter in North Adams, Massachusetts, a couple of years ago. My daughter's a vegan. And she said, we got to go get rice cakes. And I went into this Walmart and I went to a nice, you know, woman who, you know, underpaid woman who worked there. And I said, you guys have rice cakes? And he said, well, you know, we got something like that. And she took me to those Rice Krispie bars, Kellogg Rice Krispie bars. And my daughter said, we're never shopping here again. And, you know, and that's Walmart. Now, Walmart's trying like mad. They give it Irwin Simon, it's a Hain Celestial. They gave him a big contract. They said, please take over, get us some natural and organic. But, you know, it is more of an ethos. It's like you don't just get natural and organic. You think natural and organic. That's why I still like Whole Foods, even though Fairway, Sprouts, Farmers, they're all, you know, Fresh Market, they're all in there competing. But it's an ethos. And I think that you have to constantly check. You have to constantly check your thesis, or else you shouldn't, or you else you should be in a mutual fund or an index fund.
When is the right time to sell high dividend stocks? Should you keep some to diversify your portfolio?
Well, I mean, high dividend stocks are, you know, they're not a, you know, not a universe of, I mean, it's, there are different sectors that are high dividend. I mean, here, I'll give you, my mother inherited Philadelphia Electric. We sold it. But it got bought by Exelon, by ComEd, Commonwealth Ed of Chicago. And they created this Exelon, and it had a very high dividend. And it was too high. It was higher than everybody else in the sector, which is a great sign, a red flag for the fact they're going to have to cut the dividend. Like, First Energy is going to have to cut it, mm-hmm. FE, the company that caused the last big blackout. And, you know, so I could say, listen, you should diversify away from dividends. No. The dividend in Exelon is not safe. The dividend on a company that I had on tonight, Crosstex, it is safe. I mean, I care about, when I do dividends, I care about safety of the dividend. I don't care necessarily about the sector as much as I care about the safety of the dividend because I'm buying it for income. And if it's not safe, then I don't really care what it is. I don't want it.
What's the best stock in the airline industry now that American and US Air have merged?
Like, if you're a really bad author on one of these shows that I used to be on, you'd say, well, if you buy my book. but there's airlines are a classic example of the Justice Department totally folding like a cheap suit. And they blessed all these mergers, and they shouldn't have done it. There's a lot of political stuff about why they did it that I didn't include in the book. But we did a lot of work about what happens after an airline buys a rival, what happens the first year, what happens the second year. And that's the best performer. And U.S. Air and American Air merged. And the probabilities that we looked at show that that's going to be the best. I really like Delta. United Continental is very poorly run. If they got a new CEO, the stock would go up about 15% immediately. Delta is extremely well run, which means there's not a lot of room for improvement. And what I'm looking for is the company that is able to aggressively meld the root structure really stop going against other areas, which, so that, I mean, the reason why the Justice Department blessed these is, oh, there's four planes that go to Chicago, we don't have to worry about. When one goes at 9, one goes at 12, one goes at 3, one goes at 6, they used to compete against each other. It used to be 2 at 9. So when you look at the U.S. Airways AMR, they're going to get rid of a bunch of routes, and that's going to be, right now they're in the reason why the stock is trying to digest, because they have to sell some routes that were very lucrative. That was part of the deal. But I think that that's going to be the best one for 2014 is American Airlines. But you were not going to go wrong owning Delta. And if they fire the CEO of United Continental, that will be the best performer.
When analyzing a stock, rank the importance of the following items: management team, balance sheet, future earnings potential, free cash flow, revenue growth forecast.
Wow. Okay.
It's hard.
That is hard. I mean, I'm a balance sheet fiend because I can't ever be in something that has a bad balance sheet, because then that just comes back to kill me. I can't care about management until I know what the growth rate is, both earnings and sales. If it's a complicated story, then I do have to look at cash flow. I mean, you know, just look at the company, TST, the street that I work at. I mean, you have to analyze it from cash flow. It's really hard because there's this big depreciation. Now, if you don't understand depreciation, you don't understand cash flow, you got to go with a story that doesn't have that. So it's like you need to be comfortable with the metric that you look at. If you take Comcast, another company I work for, it doesn't really show a lot of earnings versus what it could show, but it's giant cash flow. So if you don't, Verizon, AT&T, big cash flow stores. If you don't understand the concept of cash flow, and I've written about it a bunch of times, I finally gave up. I said, people don't understand it. Okay, you don't need to be in a cash flow story. You can be in an earnings per share story. Like Nike is not a cash flow story. Under Armour is not a cash flow. I mean, they have cash flow. But I guess what I look at first is sales, which then tells me how big the market is. And then I would look at the earnings. And then I would look at, after balance sheet, and then I would look at management. And the cash flow is if it's an abstruse story. But there's a chapter in the book where I talk about how to figure out how to measure a company. And I measure, I do it by pitting it against another. It's something I like to do. I pit Amazon against Google against Starbucks. And I use 10-point metrics about how I value stocks, and you can figure out how, and they're equal-weighted metrics. And those are better than the different subheads we just got here. You can see the 10 categories that I care about for growth stock. And I don't really care about non-growth stock investing because I'm looking for growth stocks.
Can you tell us something about Mad Money that, as viewers, we wouldn't know about sitting at home?
Yeah, there's a guy...
I could tell you.
I read the show with my nephew. He's my sister's kid, and he's smarter than everyone in the room. He's smarter than his parents, smarter than me, smartest guy I've ever met. But he doesn't leave his room, and no one's seen him in 8 years. We had a big party last night for CNBC, and I said, oh, and I want to thank Cliff Mason. I know you're not here. Cliff is... when he was between his junior and senior year at the Hackley School my sister sent him to, he was an intern, and we used to do these conference calls at 9 a.m. And I always says, anybody have any ideas? And we did it for a year, and no one ever said anything. They were like either intimidated or I was just a jerk, I wouldn't say whatever. But does anybody have any ideas? And I said it every day. I'm just like an idiot. I have any ideas, anybody have ideas? And then one day, and then I hire my nephew as an intern. And he goes, I said, any ideas? And he goes, I think there's going to be a big student loan default, and I think we should start thinking about negative articles, doing a series of negative stories about these for-profit colleges, because they won't be able to last if there's any real scrutiny. I said, who is this? He said, it's me, Uncle Jumbo. And at the end of the summer, we were working with Jeff Zucker at that time. He works at CNN now. We had 6 writers in the show, and at the end of summer, he had come back and he said, listen, I'm going to go. I want to be an intern next year. And at the end of that summer, he came in and he said, Jim, we have 6 writers in the show. I'm going to college, and what I want to do is fire all the writers, and I'll write it with you, and we'll blow out the gross margins for the hour. 19, you need to blow out the gross margins. And I said, well, you can't, there's nepotism rules. And he said, well, let's go speak to the boss. We spoke to the boss, and the boss says, look, is it really going to work? And he said, you're going to be, he's going to Harvard. He says, you're going to go to your college dorm, and you're going to write the show with Jim? He goes, yeah, no problem, college is easy. You know, it's easy. I'm a Latin and Greek scholar. But, you know, he said, I want to take some physics courses and energy courses and chemistry because I've always wanted to know about it. I mean, like, he goes into that chemistry class that is only meant for doctors, and he gets an A in it because he's just a really smart guy. But long story short, he's been the head writer now and the only writer for the last 9 years. And I saw him at Thanksgiving, and then I saw him at Thanksgiving 3 years ago, and then I saw him at his 21st birthday, and he's 28. So I've seen him three times in the last 9 years. I asked my sister how he's doing. She said, I thought he was talking to you. but we email each other, I don't know, maybe 180 times a day. And he's always up when you are. I never know when he's not asleep. And he's my best friend, but I have no idea who he is.
That's very good. This one is more stock specific. If there were 5 to 7 stock picks for today for an IRA, what would they be? I'm 55.
Well, why don't you go over the ones that we're doing right now that we think are ones that could be good for them?
Yeah, so we rank our stocks in the portfolio 1, 2, 3, and 4. Ones would be the ones that we buy today. 2 would be ones that we buy on a pullback. And 3, ones we would sell into strength. 4s we would sell immediately when we're not restricted. When
right.
Jim speaks about a stock on TV, we can't trade it
frozen.
For 3 days. So when we say we're frozen and... but that's actually one interesting point of our alerts. When we can't trade, we actually tell everyone
right.
This is what we would do.
And you've done much better if you did. I mean, I did a study of how you had done if we weren't frozen, if you listened to the bulletins rather than do what we have to do, and you did much better. But that's somewhat obvious.
It's hard. It's a hard show. But just going back to the themes and theme
right.
investing, because that's how we approach the product as well. In terms of, we like the aerospace cycle very much,
right.
Given the replacement cycle. We own Honeywell.
That would be one. Dave Cody's one of my 21 bankables.
Yeah, I would either do Honeywell or I would do Eaton.
Right.
Eaton is a little bit more of
Same.
A hybrid, right? Sandy
Great.
Cutler is very good.
I would definitely do one of those.
You had mentioned Nike. I think that Nike
yes.
is really great company with great cash flow and really wonderful returns. We have kind of a mixture of energy stocks, and I think
right.
I'm kind of mixed on energy in general.
But you need an energy stock.
But you do need an energy stock, and we don't own Schlumberger, but that's kind of best in class and one that we like. And if you wanted to take a little bit more beta, I think National Oil Well Varco, because they are doing
right.
the spin out.
And that's the oil and gas renaissance in the book.
Yeah. And then Google, for sure.
Yeah.
The only reason I wouldn't say that at the top of the list, only because it's had such a nice run recently. Right,
but that's all right, because, and remember, that age is deceptive, because I think that a lot of people feel in their 50s and 60s that they're too old to own the stocks we just described. And that, look, go if you buy a 5-year CD, you get 0.8.
Yeah.
And no one should ever have to suffer through a 0.8.
And I still think that the auto cycle is still in kind of mid-innings in the U.S. I think they're in early innings in Europe
yep.
In terms of the turn. And in China, I think they're stabilizing. And so you could pick GM. That's one that's actually down and it's pretty cheap. Johnson Controls has an auto parts business. And they're actually doing a very nice job in terms of restructuring. So we're pretty heavy in the industrials, actually, and
right.
heavy
well,
in the financials. And I would give you just one more, one of the financials. I mean. You can pick J.P. Morgan. It's a little bit more less. It's less beta, if you will, but or Bank of America had an amazing quarter today.
They had an amazing quarter. I mean, Bank of America, if I wrote the book today, I would have said, listen, I can make some exceptions. I don't like the financials because they're very hard for people to understand.
Yeah, in your book, but, you do say that.
Right. I say, listen, it's just too hard for people to understand. Remember, you got to first do no harm. And the financials are really hard to understand. And go back to that question about do you look at management, do you look at cash flow? I mean, the metrics that you have to look, and I have the metrics for each industry in a chapter here, but the metrics that you have to look at for banks are really hard.
Yeah.
And I'm not trying to simplify anything. I am saying, listen, these are the ones that are not as hard to do. Like a lot of times people say, well, Jim, what's your favorite restaurant stock? And it's like, oh, it's so easy because restaurants are easy. I mean, I've covered every industry. Retail's really easy. And especially because I grew up in a retail background. But when you get to banks, I mean, there's this number. Oh, my God. It's like I'm speaking to the guys who run a major bank today. And I said, what do I do about the idea that people think that your bank isn't doing well because you had a 50% decline in mortgages? And a guy laughed because he said, yeah, no one makes money in mortgages. Now, okay, probably most people in this room think that banks make a lot of money in mortgages. It's a lousy business. But, you know, if you if I try to tell people that, and then there'll be someone who comes on air and says, oh my God, mortgages are so bad, you got to sell that bank. It's like, you know, the first thing you think of is like, well, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm wrong. I just heard someone on TV say that mortgages are bad and I should sell the bank. Like, it's like the fewer mortgages they have, the better. I mean, I was doing some work on Barnes & Noble for a speech I gave today, and they had a good earnings. And the reason why I saw it was Nook sales. It's kind of funny, but it turns out that it was the lack of Nook sales because they lose so much money on each Nook. So, I mean, there's different metrics. And, you know, you got to realize that the banks are losing money on mortgages. They lose money when they do a mortgage. So what it matters is that they take your deposit, you give them you buy a 5-year CD, they get 0.81, they give you 0.81, and they invest at 1.6 on risk-free. Or they invest it, they can go out a little further on the curve. They can invest at 2.2. And they just make that money every day when the lights come on. And that's the number people like. And Bank of America's number of what they pay you on your CD versus what they invest was extraordinary. And it's just the beginning.
Yeah, they had a very good quarter. And I think
it's a really good quarter.
You know, the steady name is kind of the J.P. Morgan and Bank of America. There's a lot of hedge funds in it. It's a little more beta, a little more volatile. Mm-hmm. Citigroup has a little more international exposure. So it really depends on USB is more just kind of middle America loan growth. So it kind of depends on what you're after in financials. But financials are one of the cheapest sectors in the market, in my opinion.
You know, I say they're right. I mean, a lot of my discipline came from when I worked at my hedge fund, which was brutal. I worked with Karen Cramer. Karen and I hate each other and love each other. And we used to rank these stocks every day. It's so brutal to work for Karen. I'd come in and we would be down, you know, say it was like 9:30, the market opens. She goes, okay, off the desk. Go off the desk. Remember, we were above Delmonico's. It always stunk of steak downtown. So, okay, let's go down. Bristol-Myers. Still one rated. And I said, well, you know, we would have done this last night at 4. Yes, one rated. Okay, Abbott Labs. Still one? I said, yeah, yes. Eden. Is that a 2? 2 meaning, you know, you're trying to buy more. Yeah, it's a 2. So, I mean, just go down to 20 stocks. And then it'd be like, okay, and we'll go back. And then she'd read her catalogs. Place orders, Van Zandt, I don't know, West Elm, whatever. And then like an hour later, she's right off the desk. She said, okay. All right, Bristol-Myers, is it one rated still? So like, what, did something happen, Bristol-Myers? And she said, no, this is what discipline is. Discipline is that stock is down 38 cents and I don't know why. And you're gonna get off your ass and you're gonna find out why that stock's down 38 cents or I'm gonna go make you get me a bucket of French fries. Okay, all right, I'll go find out. No, we don't do that anymore. We go over our ones and our twos, but it's a discipline. And at all times, you have to have a discipline. And by ranking things, we are able to really figure out whether we want to take advantage of a sale or whether we want to run when a stock goes up. And it's a great skill, but it's rooted in trading. But we're trying to take it to investing. And when I listen to the Bank of America, what you described, Bank of America, U.S. Bank, these are all ones. Mm-hmm. They're all ones. There's all stocks I want to buy right now. But they may not be good they're not buy and hold because there will come a time when the Fed has to raise interest rates so high, and not initially. The first 8 hikes are good for the banks. Mm-hmm. But there'll come a point where they have to raise interest rates so high that there will be other things that you'll want to buy. And you'll want to sell that. They raise interest rates high enough, and the 5-year treasury goes to 5%. I'm sorry. I'm going to sell everything. I'm going to go in the 5-year. So, I mean, and I talk about the supermarket of what you have, that's the beginning of the book, because there'll be a moment when something that's a buy and hold will no longer be a hold because of a structural change in the economy. But for the most part, my 7 themes are immune from that, and I'm trying to put you through a gauntlet, and then when you get to the 7 themes, you realize, okay, these are no longer... I don't have to worry about them being ones and downgraded to twos and downgraded to threes. They're all ones. And that's what I like.
We talked about emotional investing and trying to take the emotion out of it. When you rank a stock and we do levels every day, it does take some of the emotion out.
No, it does. I mean, that's why Karen started it. Because she wanted it to be unemotional.
Yeah.
But the problem is that when the market's down really badly, you have to circle the wagons. You got to sell all the fours. And you got to sell now because those are stocks you shouldn't even own. And you got to you have to go buy the ones, which is so painful because the market's coming down. But the discipline says you got to buy. You can't sell.
Right. I'm 24. I love Amazon. I order everything from them. But the stock, how can it trade at such a premium? Seems scary.
All right. Amazon, Tesla, SolarCity.
Netflix,
Twitter. There are no reasons why these stocks trade where they do versus other stocks. You go off the desk with a major retailer, the CEO, he's gonna complain to you, or she'll complain to you, that Amazon doesn't have to play by the rules. They don't have to make a profit, they don't have to pay a dividend, they don't have to buy back stock, they don't have to do anything. But it has pure oxygenated growth, and that's what people want. All of those companies you just mentioned are cult stocks. Mm-hmm. You can't value them very... If someone tries to give you a way to value Amazon, you have to be armed with real common sense ways. Now, I have a way to figure out why you should buy Amazon. In the book, the chapter that I spent the most time on was trying to explain to you why Amazon, which at that point was 180, it's at 400, couldn't be bought. And it's not justification, it's not rationalization. It's like, here's the way it's done. This is why big money is buying Amazon. And I want you to be comfortable with it. And if you're not comfortable with the 10-point metric about why Amazon is a buy, then you can't own Amazon. So for this youthful person, I would say, go read the metrics. Metrics take a long time to go through. And you can understand why that stock trades where it is. But what I've been using in shorthand is to say, okay, I took this class at college, and they called it spots and dots. But it was Art 104, one of the greatest courses I've ever taken. And it was about modern art. And it talked about why if you just taken your whole tuition, put it in what the guy was saying. But it talked about the notion that one day a Rothko, this is 1972, one day a Rothko or a Jackson Pollock is going to be worth more than a Rembrandt. And here's why. Okay. And every day you had this course, spellbinding course. And everybody was like, he puts up a Barnett Newman, and he puts up a Stella, and then he puts up a Renoir, and he puts up a Matisse. And he explains to you about the architectonal shift that will make it so that the paintings on the right, that the Stella is going to be worth more than the Picasso. And you're like, we're like laughing, right? But it happened, all right? The Rothko became more valuable. And what you have to recognize is that these are, in some ways, modern art. Amazon's like modern art. You can't, if you're looking at realism, you'll never buy that painting of Amazon. But if you're willing to go through the course that I give you in the book, you could at least understand why Amazon could be Rothko, okay? And it could continue to rise. You know, it's not Warhol. Warhol is Yelp. But you know, you have to understand it. And the only example that really works with a sophisticated audience like this is the pricing in art. Because you know that that's up eye of the beholder. Now, Jim Stewart, my friend, did this terrific piece recently in the Times about 2 months ago about how the puffery of pricing in art. And there's puffery of pricing in Amazon. But the bottom line is there's someone who's willing to pay that price for Amazon. And all I'm trying to do in the book is explain why that guy pays that price. And if you can get comfortable with that, you too can own Amazon. But if you can't, you should never.
Is Apple a buy, sell, or hold?
I think Apple's a buy, and...
You have to talk about the Walter Isaacson interview that you had.
Oh, yeah, I just... God, I mean, you do a lot. Again, for my friend Ed Bill Groover at Bucknell, he, for their 100th anniversary, he's just a great friend of mine. He got me started. I was a real poor kid, and he hired me at Goldman. And so I owe him for the rest of my life. Because he said, listen, poor kid, you'll be a millionaire. And in return, one day I'll come to ask you for help. It's not Godfather. He just says, what's going to happen? And so he came. He said, listen, we're having this 100th anniversary fund drive for Bucknell, and I want you out here. And I want you to be able to interview anybody you want in the whole world. Who would you like to interview? We'll get them. He says, I don't know. I just finished the Steve Jobs book. I want Walter Isaacson. He was on our squawk today. And he said, okay, well, here's what we're going to do. We're going to have a small breakfast with the biggest donors, and then we'll have a larger coffee with more donors, and then you'll interview him, and then we'll have another thing with students. Okay, so I said, oh, it sounds like a great day. So we have this really small meeting, and it happened to be 1 year after, to the day, that Steve Jobs had died. And we own Apple, and Apple's like at 720. And I was really worried because once Steve Jobs died, I said, it's just another company now. But he obviously had left some stuff legacy. And the stock kept going up and up and up. And we owned it for our trust. It was a very big position. So I know that Steve Jobs is brilliant. Everyone in the room knows he's brilliant. But I want to know what he left. Okay, so so the small meeting's probably 15 people there. And I go, and I've known Walter. I worked for Time in the 90s. And I say, Walter, small group, what exactly did Steve Jobs leave for Apple? What are the OMG products? And he says, you know, it's 1 year to the day since he died, and I promised him I would not talk about that question until 1 year. So I'm now going to tell you, nothing. No, I mean, like, how about a car that runs on water? No, nothing. I said, well, but surely he's got something in the living room, right? He's got to control the... No. I said, well, I mean, there's nothing there. And he goes, right. And I go, Stephanie, I said, Stephanie, you know, like, emailing back and forth, it's 700, 710, it's 705. It's like, we got to sell. And, you know, then, you know, I get... go back, and of course, that I mentioned on TV, and the first time we're free from for trading is down 105. But it was just incredible. It was just incredible. He left them nothing. Now, Tim Cook, whom I've gotten to know, is very different. He's an operator. He's not a promoter, and he's not necessarily a visionary. He just hired a great visionary from Burberry's. I think she's going to do a good job. Burberry's had a really good quarter today, and it was all this woman, Aarons, who is going to come over and be that person who run the retail, and she's going to put a lot of sass in the stock. But Tim is a blocking and tackling guy in a visionary's job. And do they have anything? Well, I mean, he was upset with me when I didn't think that the new operating system was that good, and he challenged me. He says, well, you know, are you using it? I said, well, I downloaded it. He said, no, have you used it? It is very different. Go read the Times article, which says it's the greatest. And what I realized was, and that's when we did get to sell some. We bought it back when the stock got to 400 and changed, because it was like the operating system's really good, and the metrics are really good, and it's very inexpensive. Could it go on forever? No. I mean, nothing lasts forever. Google's cheaper on a growth basis. That's what you have to look at it, because as I mentioned in the chapter about how to value these stocks, you have to look at 2017. And Google's cheaper on 2017 numbers than Apple is. But I think Apple's a good situation. Not a great situation, it's a good situation.
I think that the door just opened.
Uh-oh.
One last question.
Okay, we have time for one last one. Got to sign some books and stuff.
Thoughts on Twitter versus Facebook?
Oh, jeez. You know, we had a big hit in Facebook for the trust. And Stephanie and I both knew it was just a juggernaut. If they had this quarter, that was so beautiful. And that guy Zuckerberg is so smart. I mean, in a quarter, it was like jaw-dropping. You know, you listen to these conference calls. Again, if you don't listen to conference calls, please don't own a stock. Just don't. It's just not worth it. I mean, like, I was looking at the line today and how it changed for the games and made some calls on it, just trying to figure it out. And it took me longer than it would to read the Google conference call. But I'm interested because I have big fantasy guys, and I'm friends with some guys up at ESPN and stuff. I'm just saying, using that example of, like, you could have read the Google conference call. But I don't know. I'm trying to think of it.
Facebook at least has proven themselves.
Right.
Twitter has yet to even report
right.
earnings.
And I'm stumped because I know that Twitter's going higher.
Right.
And I don't want to keep anyone out of Twitter.
Right. But
I
it also
don't.
Trades at two times.
Right. I can't justify Twitter. And I mean, Twitter could be some artist who doesn't live yet.
Yeah.
But Facebook I can justify because they really have figured out a great way to make a lot of money. I mean, you know, talk to your kids, okay? You know, I told my daughter, have you ever clicked on a Facebook ad? And she goes, no, never. I said, then why did we buy 30 Red Hot Chili Pepper t-shirts? Oh, I that wasn't an ad. That was just there was a link in the Facebook page. You know, I mean, how brilliant is Zuckerberg? He's got them clicking on things. They don't even know it's ads. Twitter, on the other hand, let me tell you how I arrive at my worldview on these and why it's so Twitter's so discouraging for me. Like, I talk to almost all the major CEOs for the restaurant chains. They just like the show, you know. None of them's putting ads on Twitter. None of them. Beverage companies, nobody. Because they know they can get the same thing for free by people talking. Facebook, they need a presence. So you go to Domino's. Okay, so Domino's does probably 1/10 of its orders right now are coming from Facebook, and they just started advertising Facebook 3 months ago. But they don't do Twitter. It doesn't work for them. Twitter doesn't work for a surprising number of people, but there are enough people that it does work for that the numbers are going to be okay. But Facebook works for a huge number of advertisers of companies that we all know in this room, and they all swear by it. They swear by the return on investment. No one is swearing by, no. There's one media company that swears by the return on investment for Twitter, and 20 I know that don't. But I don't know a single company that doesn't swear by the return on investment for Facebook and does want to put more. They want to put money with Facebook, and they want to put money with Google programmatic ads. That's why Google's really great and why Facebook's great. Google's much cheaper than Facebook. But I just, you know, I just feel like I'm damned if I do and damned if I don't with Twitter, because I know that Twitter, you have to bet that Twitter's Amazon, meaning it's going to go beyond the metrics, or SolarCity, or Tesla. And I'm unwilling to make that bet, or Netflix. You have to say that the opportunity for this, the opportunity for that company is so great that its market cap is too small for the opportunity. When Netflix was at $10 billion, I said, oh, this is like a $30 billion, $30 billion opportunity for Apple or Microsoft if they bought them. So it's ridiculous that it's at $10 billion. But when it gets to $25 billion, it's not as cheap. I don't know you have to bet that the opportunity for Twitter is so immense that gigantic market cap is too small. And I just have a hard time doing that. I don't have a hard time on Facebook because I know that every company that I have dealt with off the desk, off the record, in the green room, that has put money with Facebook has said they've gotten a tremendous return from it. And that's one of the reasons why we had big it. Now, we got a double. And I say, hey, then there's a whole other discipline. After you got a double, what do you do? Well, how about taking it off the table? Well, do we take it all off the table? Well, we can't take the volatility. It's really a spec. We said it was a spec. We're not going to ride a spec up. We take our money out. And these are all the things that we write about in our bulletins. But in the end, Facebook is dramatically cheaper than Twitter. I mean, it's probably a quarter of the value of Twitter. So I like Facebook, but I would never short Twitter.
There you go.
All right.
So you're going to go sign books.
I'm going to go sign books. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.